So I want to thank the management of Sri Vidyaniketan College of Pharmacy, Tirupati, for giving me this opportunity to provide my views in this national webinar. The topic of my presentation today is collaborative research and its role in pharmaceutical sciences. And there are a few tips or there are a few tricks which we can follow so that we can do a better collaborative research, so that we can improve our research output. So this particular presentation will be having my inputs towards students. It will have some tips or tricks to the faculty members. So I will try to balance both the people, both students as well as faculty members. So we know that research is a very important part in our profession, in the pharmaceutical sciences or in the pharmacy field. Research is a very important component. And being a student or being a faculty, whoever is there in any pharmacy institution, it may be a private pharmacy college, it may be an affiliated college, or it may be an university college, or it may be an institution of national importance. So whatever may be, at whatever level it is, any institution which is offering pharmacy program is nowadays giving a lot of importance to research. And there are many types of research activity, and one of the important component is academic research. Academic research means a B-pharmacy student in his or her final year perform some project work, and to get qualified for a B-pharmacy degree, that project is very much required or it is mandatory. Similarly for an M-pharm student. Likewise, a faculty member for their own PhD purpose or for their own personal research interest, they do some research activity within that particular college, and then they publish papers, and they also bring out some of the research outputs. So in general, research happens in the college, maybe at the undergraduate level, postgraduate level, PhD level, or even at the funded project level. But there is a basic question which always remains with all of us. That basic question is, what is the impact this academic research does, or what impact this academic research creates for every one of us, maybe a student or a faculty? Is there any benefit which we can get out of this academic research? So there are two questions. What is the real purpose of doing this academic research? What impact it can create? And the second question is, what benefit we can get out of this academic research? Why we have to do this research activity? So to answer the first one, what is the real impact of any academic research? Some people will claim that in order to get promotion, in order to get an increment in my job, I want to do some research activity, and I will show that I have published this paper from this activity. Therefore, my college or my management will promote me to the next higher level. If not promotion, at least by doing some research activity, by publishing good papers, my management will provide some sort of an increment as an incentive for my research activity. Some people will claim that I do some research activity by having an award or a recognition or a fellowship from a leading society or from any international organization. By keeping that in my mind, I do some research activity. So some are interested in this research activity for achieving an award or a recognition or a fellowship from a society or from an international research organization. somebody thinks or they do these sort of academic research for creating an opportunity. What could be that opportunity? If I do some quality research, if I publish some good paper, I can go to higher studies with a good scholarship, or I can get into a good institution by showing these papers. So a B pharmacy student or a PharmD student or an M pharmacy student, whoever wants to go for higher studies, that is from B pharm to M pharm, M pharm to PhD and PhD to postdoctoral fellowship. So whatever level you want to go next with respect to higher studies, you can get your opportunity in a leading institution in India as well as in abroad. So in order to get a good opportunity related to higher studies, somebody prefer doing these sort of research activity. Others, they consider this academic research activity as an opportunity for getting a preferred job. That means someone working for a private college, they want to get into an university department, or somebody from a private sector, they want to enter into a government sector. Somebody from a non-accredited college, they want to enter into an accredited college. Somebody from an accredited college, they want to move into an autonomous college. So like this, we always look for a better job, not just in terms of pay alone. In many other ways, we look for a better job. So if we are continuously doing some quality publication and we are giving some quality research output continuously every year, then there is very high chance that we can get into our preferred job. There are few people, or there are other people, who don't look into all these previous items. They look with satisfaction point of view, self-satisfaction. They don't work for promotion, they don't do something for an increment, award, fellowship, as an opportunity for higher studies or getting a better job. They don't look into that perspective. Without having any expectation, they have only one interest, to do some sort of genuine research activity for their self-satisfaction. And of course, there is a last category which is being done on the name of compulsion. That means you have to do it. So it is not a choice. You have been asked to do some research activity, and you have been asked to publish good papers. Only then you can survive. Survival of the fittest. So sometimes there are some situations where we need to do some research activity out of compulsion. So whatever may be the reason, we always do some sort of a research activity during our profession or during our work. So is these only reasons, or is there any other reason beyond this? Of course, there are many other reasons beyond this, whatever I mentioned here. It's just a glimpse. So that's why I asked you a question. What other reason could be there to do these sort of academic research activities? Okay. So these are the impact or the benefits what we get out of academic research. Now, we have done some research activity. Now, how do our people in sense, our management, our superiors, government, like this, how do they assess our research activities? How do they quantify it? So we are being measured, or our research activity is being measured in terms of patents, or it is being measured in terms of publications. This measured in terms of publications. So these two are the most commonly used words, patents and publications, at the individual level or at the institutional level. Okay. So when it comes to patents and publications, especially papers, so some of the keywords are like, we look for the journal's impact factor, and we see how many citations are there for our paper. We look for H index value and we see the quality of publisher. Who is the publisher? So we see the quality of publisher and we see whether we have published many papers in the OpenSS journal. So these are some of the indicators, or these are some of the tools for measuring our research activities. Okay, so is there any other tool to measure our research contributions? Yes, there are many. Patents and publications are one of the important measures. So naturally the next question arises, what are the other tools or what are the other measures for our research activity? So at the end of this presentation, I would like to justify, I will try to answer these two questions. What are the benefits of academic research and how do we measure our research activities? So that will be answered at the end of the presentation. Now, in the previous slide, I was telling that our research activities are being measured in terms of the patents, or it is being measured mainly in terms of publications. But there are many more. So I have highlighted some of the important research outputs here. So you can see one of the important research output is a thesis or a dissertation. So what is a thesis? A B-pharmacy student or a PharmD student perform some research activity. So what they do at the end of their project work, they write a thesis, a B-pharmacy thesis or a PharmD thesis, or maybe a dissertation, and then they submit it to the university for the award of degree. Similarly, the master's student, for getting their master's degree, they do some project work in their second year. They write a thesis from their research activity and then they submit it for their award of degree. Similarly, PhD. Okay, so thesis is one of the important research output. It has a good weightage. Now, what is second? It is a very traditional method. We do some research activity, and earlier we used to do a lot of conference presentations. We go to a conference, we go and attend a conference within the state, outside the state, sometimes even outside the country. We go and participate in these sort of conferences and we present our research work in those conferences. Okay, either as a poster or as a oral presentation. Similarly, in the last few years, other than just going and presenting our paper there in a conference as an abstract, as a poster or as a oral presentation and getting a certificate, other than that, in the last few years, the concept of conference proceedings has been introduced. That means whatever we present, that abstracts will be printed as a book, or it will be connected to a journal, and as a special issue, all our conferences abstracts will be printed in that particular journal special issue. That will be called as proceedings. So whenever we think about any conference presentations, it's not just about presenting a poster or an oral presentation. After that, we should get a certificate, of course, but we should always prefer a conference or an event where there will be a proceedings which will be published at the end of that particular conference. Such events are gaining importance, are given more importance. Okay, and sometimes a research output can also be exhibited to everyone, even to the public, through the exhibitions or some of the exhibiting events. We can go and showcase our research activity in the exhibitions. So it is also a form of showcasing your research activity. For example, you have created some product, you have developed some app, Okay, so you can go and show it in an exhibition, a scientific exhibition or a technical fair, which is conducted related to your field. Even the public also will get that information through that exhibit. And sometimes, based on your research activity, you can publish an article. You can write an article in a newspaper, or you can write it in a scientific magazine, or you can create your own blog, and then you can showcase your research output in the form of an article. And of course, everyone knows we do some research and we always think about publishing our work in the journals, scientific journals. So there are many types of journal publications. There are review articles, there are original research articles. There is also a concept called a short communication. Short communication means you have done some genuine research activity and you send that manuscript to a leading journal or a quality journal. Sometimes they say that your volume of work or the parameters, whatever you measured, will not be sufficient enough to meet the journal standards. Okay, the parameters evaluated. So this doesn't, with respect to volume or with respect to quality, sometimes may not be able to fulfill our requirement for original research work. In that case, because of some novelty and because of a limited parameters which has been assessed, and sometimes the journal itself will recommend, why not you try for a short communication? Still, short communication is a very, very good opportunity to publish our research work in the journal articles. Okay. Likewise, for PharmD students, okay, you can always publish your work in the form of case reports. You look into a case in detail. You give your opinion, okay? Get it revised by the experts, and then you communicate that case in a suitable form to the respective journal, a clinical journal, and try to publish it as a case reports. Still, it has a good reputation. And sometimes, once we become experienced, maybe some 15 years, 20 years, or once we become an expert in that particular field, and we have a good track record of publishing in a particular area. So sometimes some journals, okay, they will give a chance to write an editorial content. So this opportunity doesn't come in our early part of our research phase. Once we are experienced, or once we are considered to be an expert, and when we have a proven track record in that particular area, so over a period of time, we may get an opportunity to write an editorial related to a particular theme. So we can try all this. So what is the message here? It is not only about original research article category. Even we can write a very good review article and then we can publish papers. Similarly, if we have taken a very small concept and we have done a quality research, then we can always think about short communications. And for PharmD students, there is a lot of opportunities in this particular area, case reports. So, and there is a less competition in all these areas, especially there is a less competition in review. There is a less competition in short communications, and still more less competition in case of case reports. So by exploring all these categories, we can very well publish our research works in this scientific journals. And not only about journals, we can always think about writing something to the books. There are many categories. One is called an authored book. That means you yourself, as a single author, you write a book. Naturally, this comes out of experience, and you should know the art of writing. Sometimes, if you don't find time, And if you want to write in a very very impactful book, then what you can do is you can take two or three more of your friends on board, and then you can select a theme and you can divide the chapters between you, and collectively you can write one book. And third category of book writing is edited book. Means if a book contains 15 chapters, you think that as a person you are able to write only one or two chapters. Now what you can do is you can approach a publisher, and then by showing your track record, you get the permission as a editor of a book with a particular title or a particular theme, and then you just propose what could be the overall titles or chapters. And after getting the permission from the publisher, now you can call for individual book chapters to the others who are related to that particular theme or to that particular field. So each one will come will contribute one chapter. Like that, you collect 13 chapters and you add your own two chapters, and being an editor, you publish your book with the leading publishing house. And to start with, where I can start writing a book. So the order is something which you can start from a book chapter. That means first, to get an experience, you write one chapter for a good book. After getting an experience, then what you do? You try to increase the number of book chapters, and that too with the quality publishers. And slowly now you move to the next levels. So like start with book chapters, then try to be a joint author, then try to be a author, and then try to be an editor. So like this, you can change your gears once you get experience. And there is one more research output, which is called collaborative research. What is this collaborative research? You alone, if you are not able to do a research activity, if you think that if someone can help me in this research activity, or I find a research facility in that college, or in that particular organization, or in that particular company, so let me combine with them, take their help, make use of their facility, and let us do this research in a collaborative manner. And whatever research output which is being generated out of this, let us give credit to each other. So that is called as collaborative research. Of course, this collaborative research is the central theme of today's presentation. Why we have to give importance for this collaborative research. And there are other research activities, like you can do a consultancy research. That means you have a skill on a particular work, you are an expert, somebody needs your help, they can pay you, okay? Or they can provide the necessary chemicals and you can do it on an honorary basis. So that is called a consultancy research. And the other important category is, once you have a good track record and doing this quality research work, then after a period of time, you always think about getting a sponsored or a funded research activity. So you try to apply for grants from the leading funding agencies like DST, DBT, ICMR, so UGC, okay, AICT. Like this, you apply to several of these funding agencies and try to get research grants, and then try to do your research. So getting a sponsored or funded research only is possible only when you have shown some interest, when you have some track record of doing some quality research, and you have some research output in that particular area by which you can claim that if you give me funding, I will be able to do a quality data, and then I will be able to submit it. So by seeing your skill set, by seeing your track record, they may consider in giving a grant to you. So these three are very important categories. So we are, as a faculty member, we have to look into all these three categories simultaneously. We have to think about collaborative research, we have to think about consultancy research, and then we have to, of course, aim for a funded research activity. And the other important activity, which is nowadays very common because of all these accreditations and because of all this ranking system in place, Patents are nowadays considered to be a very important tool. Some 5 to 10 years back, everyone was speaking about journal publications. 15-20 years back, everyone was speaking about conference papers, oral presentations. Now the trend has already reached to patents. So now patents are given more importance. And similarly, one of the research output can be that by doing some quality research, you get some award or you get some recognitions from the research organizations, from the state government, central government, international organizations, or from other governments. So when you get such recognitions, that is also considered to be one of the research outputs. And sometimes by doing some quality research work and having a very good research output, sooner or later, we may also get some fellowship from a research organization. So there are many levels of this fellowships. So now the tip or the message here from this particular slide is, so this research outputs are not just meant only for the faculty members. So a B-pharmacy student or a PharmD student or an M-pharmacy student, right from their first year, they should start thinking about all this. They should not wait that I'm just in my first year, I'm in my second year of my B-pharm or PharmD, so I'll have time. Let me come to the fourth year. Let me come to my fifth year or sixth year of PharmD. Then I will think about all this. Don't wait for that. So start early. Get your experience. Build up your experience, expertise in that particular area. So by the time you get 4 years or 5 years or 6 years of experience as a student, by that time itself, you know what is the way forward and you know how to maximize this, how to create a very strong impact. So when you create such an impact within that 4 years or within that 6 years at being a student, naturally your next opportunities are very easier. So you can get a better job. You can get your higher studies into premier institutions. And most importantly, you will get your own self-confidence. You will get that self-confidence. You will start believing yourself, which is the best thing which you can achieve out of this sort of research activities. So these are some of the important points which I want to highlight. Of course, because there are students as our audience, I want to define what is collaborative research. Collaborative research is a type of research activity, but the only difference is it involves the coordination between the researchers. It needs the coordination with an institution, or it may have a coordination with an organization, and sometimes it may even involve the community. It can even involve the public also. So collaborative research can be done between the researcher, between the institutions or the organizations, sometimes between the researcher and with the community. So a coordination is required between these people. Now, what are the different types of collaborative research activity? First thing is, you collaborate within the institution. For example, I am a pharmacology faculty. I want to do some phytopharmacology research. So then what I have to do? I have to collaborate with pharmacognosy department. I may need to collaborate with analysis department so that I can give a best research output. So this is called a collaboration within the institution. When you collaborate effectively within the institution, between the departments, the research output will be very high. And second type is, you can always collaborate with a private company. You can always collaborate with an industry. So there are certain industries which are ready to collaborate with the academic institutions. So you can always look for such opportunities. You have to reach out to those people and try to do a collaborative work with the industry. Little tough, but still possible. And weightage is more. Similarly, you can always collaborate with another institution. That means I am from Bapatla College of Pharmacy, and now I am speaking with Sri Vidyaniketan College of Pharmacy. Now you may be an expert in one field and I may be an expert in another field. So I can collaborate with your institution between faculty to faculty or between the institutions, and we can carry out a common research activity, and whatever research output which we generate out of this collaboration, we can share it between our institutions so that the weightage will be high. And sometimes we may not be able to go to another institution and do our research activity. In that case, we can always do it with the third point. But if you have the opportunity to go and do your research activity in another institution, get their permission, go there, be there for 2 or 3 weeks, do that research activity there, and then generate some research output, write a paper then and there itself, and then try to publish it by sharing between these two institutions. So research collaboration with other institution can be done by visiting that institution and doing a research activity there. Even without visiting that institution also, we can still collaborate and then do it. And the other type of research collaboration is that you collaborate with those people who are expert in that particular area. For example, I am very much interested in phytopharmacology research. Sometimes I have a problem in extraction or isolation of compounds. So now what I can do? If I don't find an expert in isolation of a phytocompound, then I can always look for some institution where that facility is there, where such an expert is there to help me in isolating the phytocompounds. I can reach out to them, I can call them, or I can go and meet them in person and then ask their help in doing this isolation of phytocompounds. If they are willing, we can do it on a collaborative basis. And of course, then when I write a paper, I can add that particular person as a co-author because he has contributed on my research activity. He helped me in doing this isolation. But of course, when he helped me, I should provide all the necessary facilities. I have to provide that chemicals and I have to fund that particular activity. So that is also a very important criteria. And whatever we are doing now here, from type 1 to type 5, all this can be attempted not only at the state level or at the national level. This can be very well done at the international level. So it's a little difficult process. It takes a lot of efforts. Sometimes you may need to travel to those countries. You may need to visit that particular universities. And then you have to showcase your potential. You have to show your commitment to them. And you have to show in what way both these institutions can be mutually beneficial. By proving all this, we can get into this research collaborations. And understand, there are people who are very successful at the individual level, who are very successful at the institutional level, who have already achieved this international research collaborations. And we have to always think about these opportunities also. Okay, so now how this collaborative research activity can be very beneficial to our research and how it can also help in our career. So if you do a collaborative research, what will happen? Our research output will be maximized. When I do it alone, sometimes I may not be able to give a quality product. My knowledge or my resources will be limited. But when I combine with somebody within the institution, outside the institution, or with an international institutions, then what will happen? my research output will be maximized. Maybe I can publish a good quality paper, or my paper may be accepted in a journal with very high impact factor. That is one benefit. Second, individually, my identity is improved. I will be getting recognized by my peers. I will be recognized by the nearby institutions. I will be recognized by my own country researchers. And over a period of time, I may also get recognized globally or internationally. So in order to create a maximum impact, or in order to create a good research identity, collaborative research may be a better option. And when I keep on doing such collaborative research activity and then proving myself, definitely over a period of time, I can get funding. That means I may get a funded or a sponsored project. If I keep on doing a quality research activity, somebody may approach me for a consultancy work. Or even somebody may later approach me for a collaborative research activity. So I can get funds if I do a lot of collaborative research activity. And most importantly, by doing all this, our network expands. So when I prove myself, I have all the skill sets, then naturally, I may find a potential employer, or I may find a suitable mentor for my higher studies or for my next job opportunity, higher or a better job opportunity. So collaborative research is one of the very important way for expanding your network, mainly to identify a suitable mentor or to get a good opportunity related to your higher studies or for your job. And most importantly, you will develop some sort of a curiosity for new things. You will become more and more innovative. Your scientific integrity or your quality will improve day by day. And your thinking will start expanding, okay? So you will start exploring new things. So these are some of the important benefits what you can get out of collaborative research for your research career as well as for your job. And one of the important tip regarding this, you give first, then you take. When you give and you take, definitely it can lead to success. Okay, now I want to clearly tell what is the benefit for everyone. First, let me tell to the students. By doing this collaborative research activity, by supporting your faculty members, by getting involved in your academic activity, by doing some mini projects or minor projects, you learn that skill. You acquire that particular skill. Okay, so that is the first benefit you get. And through your faculty, you identify a suitable mentor for your career, or you identify a mentor for your research activity. So it can be your own faculty, or through your faculty, you can get somebody from outside your institution. So you can identify your mentor for your research or for your career. By doing these sort of collaborative research, your opportunities for higher studies in a better institution or in a highly ranked institution with scholarship benefits or other things, the chances may be increased by involving in this collaborative research activities. Of course, if you have published a paper during your B-Pharmacy days or during your PharmD days, and when you apply for a higher study in abroad, when you show that already I have done some quality research publications, by seeing that publication, sometimes that university in abroad may provide you with some special scholarship. If you are able to save 1 or 2 lakhs of your tuition fee in abroad by showing 1 or 2 quality research papers. 2 lakhs is a huge money. You cannot think about a publication after completing your PharmD and then by showing a paper to an university. The time will be very less. So what you need to do? You need to think about these sort of publications during your college days itself. You have to start early. That is what I want to say. And of course, if an M-Pharmacy student is listening to this presentation, if you contribute or if you get involved in all this collaborative research activity at the college level, you have very high chance of getting a job in a leading company. Not only in company, in whatever job you want to get, the best job you can get by being involved in this set of collaborative research activities. And now, what are the benefits for the faculty? Of course, we can increase our research output. Till now, we have no quality publications in Science Direct or in PubMed. You can always get your publication into all these databases. If you have no publication with impact factor more than 1, now by doing this collaborative research activity, there is a very high chance that you can get a very good impact factor in a quality journal. Similarly, you will be identified by others as an expert, and that will have a greater impact on your career. Now, within the institution, when you are working for an institution, when you are identified for your quality research activity and research output out of that, any management will always try to hold you, or it will always try to retain you by providing promotions or increments at the right time. They will always try to maintain, or they will try to retain you. So in order to get respect, in order to get promotion or increment, you have to prove yourself in terms of research activities also. Other faculty member, when you do it continuously over a period of time, it will give a clear path for a better job. If you have only masters, you can do your PhD by showing your research publications with your master's level or when you are working as a faculty. And most importantly, if not all the above, sometimes you can do this sort of work at least for job satisfaction or to get recognition from the other people. So job satisfaction or recognition can be also a very important benefit out of this research activity. Now, what is the benefit of this collaborative research at the institutional levels? Now, throughout India, throughout the world, rankings nationally or internationally is gaining momentum. Institutions who are having a very good ranking, top rankings nationally or internationally, they get best students, they get more quality students, they get more funding. So for all these benefits, like to get a good NIRF rank, to get this research innovation rankings, in order to get international rankings, if you are an university, QS ranking, D rankings, A or WA rankings. So in order to get all these international rankings, though these rankings are mainly meant for universities, but there are some institutional level activities also. Institutional rankings also are possible internationally. So in order to get international rankings, we can do it. And similarly, if our college needs to get NBA accredited, NAC accredited, so these sort of accreditations, if you want to get, we have to show some sort of collaborative research activities. And by doing all these collaborative research activities, the college can get good number of admissions, and it can also get good research fundings, which will benefit the institutions. So now, what are the skill sets which are required? In order to do an effective research collaboration, we should have all these skills. Some of them are, we have to get on with people. We have to easily mingle with people. We should not hesitate. We should not feel shy. So we should develop that ability to communicate with people easily. That is a very important quality which is expected. And most importantly, we have to listen to others. And we have to contribute, and we have to respect the contribution of others. Not just getting only, you have to give. That is what I said. And we have to be very much open-minded, because it's a collaborative research activity. There will be some challenges, there will be some differences. We have to be very much open-minded. And because it's a teamwork, sometimes because it's a collaboration between one institution and another institution, sometimes we may need to compromise for good thing. And we should always think on a bigger picture. We should not be narrow-minded. We should not focus on a smaller things. We have to see things on a bigger picture. And of course, we should develop some problem-solving abilities. Being a teamwork, there should be that ability to solve the problems. You should find solutions. And you should develop your project management skills, and you should be a good organizer. You have to do things systematically. And whenever required, you should be able to give a very constructive feedback to your team members. Similarly, if your team member is giving some feedback, you should be keeping your ears open to receive that feedback appropriately. So you have to give constructive feedback, and you should be having that mind to receive the constructive feedback from others. And most importantly, if you want to get involved in this sort of collaborative research activity, we should have that commitment, or we should have that enthusiasm to do something new. We should try. Only then we can achieve. So commitment and enthusiasm is very important aspect for an effective collaborative research activity. Now, how do you find a research collaborator? The tip is that I have mentioned in the right-hand side. Through social media, through LinkedIn, through Facebook, you can find a potential research collaborator. By searching in journal databases like PubMed or Science Direct, you can find a suitable research collaborator. It may be an individual or it may be an institution. For a student or a PhD scholar, you can identify a good mentor for your research activity. How to do that? There is a cycle which I have shown here. The cycle is, you identify a mentor or a potential research collaborator. You listen and follow them. If possible, try to meet them in person, or at least make some telephonic conversation with them. Then collaborate and do some research activity. Then showcase your activity. And later, you try to motivate others. So I will end this presentation by quickly showing how to find a research collaborator or a mentor through journal databases. Okay. And quickly, give me a minute. I'll show you. I hope everyone is able to see the screen. Is it visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Just, this is a Science Direct page. Now, how can you use this to find a suitable mentor for your research collaboration? So you find something like advanced search. German sir, can I take another 10 minutes?
Yes, you can.
Can I continue?
You can continue.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So see here, there is something called advanced search here, and you find all these tabs here. There is a word called author affiliation. There is a word called author affiliation. just now type some words. For example, you want to find a mentor or you want to find a research collaborator in USA. Now just see here, I have already tried this. So I have typed Andhra because we are in Andhra. I typed Andhra. Then we need to find somebody from pharma. Then I need somebody from USA to collaborate. So I'm just typing USA. Three words. These three words I'm using in author affiliation. Now search. Now you can see there are three results which are showing. Now just click on that particular article. Click on that particular article. Now you find some author names. Now just click on this. In this, just click on this show more option. See here. If you want, for example, if you are thinking about the computational studies and if that is your area of interest. So now you see there are people who are from Tirupati. This author is from Tirupati. Who is this? Raghunath Ramabhadran. He is from ISSER Tirupati. And now you can see this person has collaborated with Dr. Muhammad Husaini, who is working for Nanyang Technological University in Singapore. And you can see the third one, Dr. Steven is working for an US-based company. And the fourth author is from UK, is from UK. So now it's very easy to find a collaborator. Only thing is, you have to see whether the publication or the paper is related to your area. So one simple example of how to find a potential collaborator. You want to get the details, you want to know where they are working, you want to get their contact details, just click on this. Now at the right hand side, you can find his name, where he is working, and even you can find his email ID. You can find his email ID. So very easy to find. Now you have to use that filters appropriately. It's not just finding with the place. Sometimes you can use the keyword search. There are many fields are there. You can use the fields to find. I'll show you another one more example from the same page. Okay. So now let us see another one more. Okay, so I'll search with something else. So everything is a book. It will be difficult to demonstrate with a book. I'll show from others. Okay. So let us search Andhra Singapore Pharmacy. So see here. Now let us check this article and see who is this. So now Aditya Murthy, he is from BITS Pilani, Hyderabad, and now he has collaborated with Department of Pharmacy, National University of Singapore. It is one of the top ranked universities in the world, National University of Singapore. So now this BITS Pilani person has collaborated with Department of Pharmacy and National University of Singapore. Now the quality of his paper has been increased when these two institutions, BITS Pilani is a premier institution in India, And National University of Singapore is one of the top ranked universities in the world. So now when these two institutions combine together, the value of this paper goes up. The impact factor of this particular paper goes up. So now you can find the details. So now you can see Punna Rao Ravi. So you can see the contact details. You find the email ID. Just mail to them. If this is your area of research, you can always do it. So you can search by author affiliation. You can search by title, keywords. You can search for a selective word within that particular abstract or within that manuscript. So there are many ways by which you can search. So I used author affiliation because it is very easy to demonstrate, but now you can use all these fields. You can see there are many fields by which you can find a potential collaborator. Similarly, now I'll show another one more useful one, which is PubMed. Okay, very helpful for PharmD students, and it will be very useful for faculty members as well. Now you see in the PubMed, there is something called advanced. Click this advanced. You find a search box like this or a toolbox like this. Now you type Andhra. Now you add another keyword here, pharma. And you add one more word, Singapore. Or you type Malaysia. You type Malaysia and now search. See, now there are two papers here. You can just click on this first one. Click on this first one. You see n number of authors. Usually we try to publish paper only with two or three authors and maximum six. But see here, there are around 14 people in one paper, and they have selected such a journal which gives permission to include this many number of authors. Now you can see out of many Singapore names or maybe other foreign names, you find a name called Nageshwar Reddy. So now just click on this expand section. See, you will be surprised. One paper having contributors from China, Malaysia, and for India, it is from Asian Healthcare Foundation, India Institute of Medical Sciences, Hyderabad. And you have one person from Japan, Singapore, Korea, Thailand, Taiwan, Hong Kong. So nearly 14 authors, 14 contributors from around 6 to 7 countries, they combine and they have written this particular article. Now what happens? When you have these many number of potential collaborators and you have done some study by involving different institutions, different hospitals from different countries, the quality of paper goes up and the impact factor also will be increased. So one important point here which I want to say is not just for publishing alone. First you have to do a research activity by collaborating, and after completing the research activity, you have to write a paper by having all their names or all their contributors' names in that particular article. So it is not that you do a research activity in your college, you have not involved anybody from abroad, you have done it within your institution. Just for getting impact factor or just for publishing quality paper alone, you cannot use the foreigner's name. You can't do it. And if you do it, it is an unethical practice. Sooner or later, you will be caught. So this collaborative research paper has to come only from a collaborative research work, or at least a collaborative review work. So there should be some contribution by all these people. Only then their names can be there as a co-authors. Just on a honorary basis, you cannot acknowledge all these papers. So that is another one more important lesson from this. So now I will complete this by saying another one more. When you search, you see here, I used a word all field. You can choose, or you can find a mentor or an institution by selecting this affiliation option, or you can search by the author names, you can search by the book title, you can search by the keywords. Okay, so by using all this, you can select or you can identify a suitable mentor, that is an individual, or you can even find a suitable person from abroad. Okay, one more search. For example, I type Bapatla College of Pharmacy and I add another one more word, USA. Okay, then now I'm searching. Let me see whether is there anything. No. So with this affiliation, there is no one with USA. Okay, so you can search by the institution names and then you can do it. Okay, so this is one of the important aspects in finding a potential research collaborator. A research collaborator can be an individual or it can be an institution. We can use appropriate fields for searching this. Each one has some trick, each one has a tip how to use a proper term in finding a potential collaborator easily. So in some other point of time, or even you can try by yourself and then you can learn from this, because these two are these two databases doesn't need institutional login. Straight away you can, you yourself can make a search. I have used this, but there are many other databases for which you may need an institutional login to go and find a potential collaborator or a institution. So this is what I want to show to you people. And finally, I want to wish you all good luck. I hope I have given some basic tips and tricks for a meaningful collaborative research activity. And there are two more related presentations from me related to these areas. So you can, if you can click on this particular link which I have shared with your sir, you can always find two more presentation related to it. Or in YouTube, you can just search for word academic pharmacy, a channel called Academic Pharmacy, and there are only two videos. Just you can go through those videos whenever you have free time. Those two videos are also related to this particular content, but it has a different theme. Okay. And finally, I want to acknowledge the management of Sri Vidyaniketan College of Pharmacy, Tirupati, and also my management, Bapatla College of Pharmacy, and my sincere thanks to Dr. Jayaraman sir and his team, and the principal of Sri Vidyaniketan College of Pharmacy for giving me this opportunity. Thank you. Sir.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful session. We rarely get this kind of opportunity to listen to the words of a great knowledgeable speaker. Thank you so much, sir. Hope your lecture will enlighten our students, research scholars, and other faculty members too. Now the session is open for queries. We have some questions, sir.
Yes.
In the chat box.
Yes.
One of the delegate has asked how to connect for how to get connected for international collaborative research.
Yeah, that is what I showed at the end. I think the person who asked this question will look into my last demo part. I have opened a Science Direct. I have opened a database like PubMed, and using a search called author affiliation, there we can type Andhra, USA, whichever country you prefer. For example, you prefer somebody from UK, just type Andhra, type pharmacy, and then use the word UK. So now what will happen? You will find somebody who has already been in touch with somebody in Andhra. So it is very easy to find a potential collaborator by using these two words. If you don't want to use the word Andhra, just type pharma and or pharmacy and type UK. You will get many articles, and through that article you can find many collaborators. But the problem here is somebody from UK may not be straight away interested in connecting with us. So you need a channel. That is why I added that word Andhra here. So if somebody from Andhra has been already in touch with somebody in UK, through this Andhra person you can always go to that UK collaborator, or you can go to that UK institution. So that is the trick here. Tip is to use word pharma and UK in author affiliation so that you can find a potential collaborator. But the trick is to very easily connect with them. You add one more word called Andhra so that you will find a channel, or you will find a help to reach out to those people. And still, if you have any difficulty, you can personally call me, and then you can ask, or I can share that through phone. And of course, if you see that and you try by yourself, you will learn this trick.
Any MOUs are required for this collaborative research?
Yes, of course. If it is with an international university, or if it is with an international organization, they won't straight away coordinate, or they will not collaborate on an individual basis, because there are many intellectual matters involved, and there may be a need for investing time. Their time needs to be invested. They have to use their institutional resources. And most importantly, because their institutional integrity or their institutional values are also involved. Generally, these international universities, they don't collaborate on individual basis. You have to approach them. You have to get their prior permission. Their university people has to give the approval. But it is not difficult. First, only thing is you have to go through all that formalities. Some university will be asking you to sign a memorandum of agreement, or just for a small task alone, they may sign an agreement and then they may do it. Some universities may be a little liberal, okay? So they believe in those faculty members and then say, okay, it is between you can do it. But make sure that ethical practices are being followed, integrity is being applied. All these things they will ask their own people to make sure. But in general, there is a need for an agreement between individuals or between the institutions whenever we look for an international research collaborations.
So can you name some short communicator journals with Scopus or UGC approved.
Name some?
Short communicative journals.
Short communication journals. Almost all the pharmacy journals, I can say up to 90% of the journals which are approved by UGC or which is indexed in Scopus or Web of Science. These three are now very basic quality databases: UGC, UGC CareList, Scopus, and Web of Science. So in all these three databases, whatever journals are there, all these journals, to an extent of 90 to 95%, all these journals will be having one category called as short communications. No doubt at all. Still, if you want a list, I can share you the latest Scopus pharmacy journals list, or I can share with you the latest Web of Science journal list with your college, and from your college the participants can always get the journals names. But every journal will be having this category almost.
Thank you, sir. I hope all the participants have cleared their doubts. Now I request our HOD to state our guest virtually with an e-certificate.
Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful and informative sessions. Definitely the participants enjoyed the learning, and particularly in the last slide you have shown how to choose the institution and how to find a proper mentor, their affiliations and other details. Definitely helpful for the investigators. Okay. So by considering the pattern, it's with a sum of love and appreciations. So now we have virtual felicitations. You can find the felicitations certificate over here. So the same we will courier you. So thank you. Thank you for your informative sessions.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for accepting.
Thank you, Dr. Jaraman sir. Thank you, Navina Kumari. Thank you to all the organizing members of this particular national webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It's time to conclude the session. Now I invite Mrs. Sri Radhika to propose vote of thanks.
A graceful and warm welcome to all. Myself, Mrs. C. Radhika, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmacology. It gives me honor and pleasure to propose vote of thanks on this. I would like to thank our Chairman, Dr. M. Mohan Babu Garu, CEO, Mr. Vishnu Garu, Director come Advisor, Dr. L. M. Gopal Reddy Garu, Director, Dr. Giridhar Reddy Garu, Director of Finance Administration, Dr. Chetra Garu, for providing us certificate to conduct this national. In this occasion, I would like to thank our principal, Dr. Anna Balaji Garu, who was a guiding stone, successful company. Now, I would like to extend a very known vote of thanks to our resource person, Dr. M. Satish Garu, who delivered a commendable talk on tips and tricks of collaborative research in pharmaceutical sciences and how it benefits to students, faculty, and institutions. Thank you, sir. We are really enlightened your knowledge, sir. I also wish to express my gratitude to Dr. K. Saravan Kumar, HOD, Department of Pharmaceutics, for smooth conduct of webinar. Special thanks to our team members, Dr. R. Jayaraman, HOD, Department of Pharmacology, organizing secretary for the webinar, Mr. T. Sudhir Kumar, Mr. K. Naveen Kumari, and Ms. Gautami for smooth conduction of the webinar. I extend my hearty vote of thanks to the honorable delegates who blessed us with their presence and took out valuable time of their visit. Last but not the least, thanks to all the faculty members of Sri Vidyaniketan College of Pharmacy who gave their valuable support to the successful completion of this webinar. Once again, thank you, one and all.